garden party to reminisce with my old friends. A chance to share old memories and play our songs again. When I got to the garden party, they all knew my name. No one recognized me. I didn't look the same, but it's all right now.
5 minutes after 9 o'clock. Thank you for tuning in. Last week at this time, Caroline Baldwin was in the studio giving advice, like she's going to do right now. But today she's in her car somewhere. And last week I had my camera in here. So if any of you have ever not seen, if you've never seen Caroline Baldwin, you want to see her in action. We made a little video last week. Actually, you can see her all the time except for today on the streaming video, which we do from WOCA. But kind of got a little behind-the-scenes stuff with Caroline last week. Not much, just her walking in and chatting with Joe before she went on the air. And now she's somewhere in her car ready to answer your questions. So if you have a question for Caroline, the phone number is, as always, the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-WOCA. The show is brought to you in part by, and I think this is Caroline's...
It's a Black Cow Calmanor.
Black Cow Calmanor. Good morning, Caroline. How you doing?
Good. I'm good, Larry. How are you this morning?
Pretty good. You've got a busy day, so you couldn't afford the time to get over here, huh?
Right, right. I just had a little too much to do at work today, so I figured I can sneak an hour out of my day and do it instead of having an extended time that I don't get into till late. Well, it's still apparently springtime, and the nice cool temperatures, I'm sure, is going to have everybody out in their lawns and landscapes today. Beautiful out.
Yeah, I don't know the official answer to this question, but do you know, was that a record cold last night, a record low?
I'm not sure, but this morning I looked and it said 46 degrees, so I was a little chilly, had to have a sweatshirt when I left the house this morning.
Yeah, it felt good though.
It was a nice change, but it is a little odd. It made the 14th of having temperatures that chilly.
Yeah, right.
Nothing got hurt in the garden. There's no worry on that. That, you know, we weren't cold enough to cause any problems, so nobody has to worry about that kind of issue. That the, you know, a few degrees cooler than normal is not a reason to have any concern or panic on, oh, what's going to happen to my
right. The phone lines are open, by the way, if you want to call in and ask Caroline a question, and see it ringing right now. So let me go right to the phone.
All right.
And you should be able to hear each other. If not, let me know right away, and I'll do whatever I need to do. Good morning. You're on the air with Caroline.
Good morning, everyone. I have a quick question about camellias, and I'm going to hang up so I can listen.
Okay.
What is the rule of thumb? I worked with Harold for years, but it was for another reason. He showed, so he always said trim it so you could throw a scalded cat through it. But now I'm having spray service tell me, as my clients come to me saying, you need to cut back the camellias by a third every couple of years, and I've never heard this. Can you elaborate on this? Have you heard anything about it? And I'll hang up and listen.
Okay, Kathy. Camellias, I've never really heard that you need to cut them back by a third every couple of years, except for maybe to renew some wood in there, or to maintain shape and size. Possibly it would improve flowering quality or quantity on those. And I know when Harold, he used to show some beautiful camellias, and with that, it's moreover just on going with the health of the plant. The camellia, I guess, if you were to take it back, because we try not to prune any more than one third off of any tree or shrub or anything at any given time, just because the amount of shock we can put the tree in or the other shrub. Camellias are a good sized plant. Taking a third out may only be shortening two or three branches, or removing one or two that may be getting a little bit crossed or anything like that. I wouldn't necessarily say I have to take off one third every two or three years. Moreover, is I'm going to selectively prune when necessary and adjust for shape and the little dead branches and things like that. And I'm hoping that answered on that. If that hopefully, Kathy, that made sense.
Do you work with a lot of people who show plants, like she was talking about how they would show them, or...
Harold Goforth, he was a master gardener, but he also showed camellias, was a big member at one time, president of the Camellia Society, here in Marion County, and that's where that, you know, that show that many, many years ago when it began, he was a big member of the organization, and his blooms were magnificent. His trees were just absolutely gorgeous. But then again, he selectively removed buds from branches. He treated with special chemicals in order to get those blooms to open at just the right time to improve their size and quality. I mean, there's quite a bit of science into some of these shows that you see when you have either, you know, maybe you'd say a semi-pro who's growing them truly as a hobby passion.
Uh-huh. And it looks like you have another phone call.
Okay.
Good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
Yeah, good morning, Carol Ann.
Good morning.
It looks like we did set the record. I believe it was 47, and we had, I think it was officially 46 in the city, so did it again.
We did it again, setting records.
Right. I've got an area on the north side of my building that I kind of like would like to put some tomato plants in, but it's only going to get a late afternoon sun, maybe 2-3 hours at the most. Is there any particular type of tomato plant that would be friendly in more of a shaded atmosphere? I know most of them like a lot of sun.
Yeah, they usually like a lot of sun. You're going to need at least, I would say, you know, 4 to 6 hours of sun in order to get fruiting to really occur.
Yeah.
What'll happen is they'll get tall and leggy, and may not set fruit as well. As it gets hotter in the season, the shade's going to give them a little bit cooler temperature, which may help.
Yeah.
You might want to try some of the ones that have the shorter, when they tell you that the length of days.
Okay.
You know, it may say 45 days, it may say 65 days. You might look for one of the ones that are the shorter days, maybe the smaller tomatoes, like say an early girl, not necessarily a cherry tomato, but a patio tomato, a salad tomato.
Right. Would the same be true for like a green pepper?
Same thing. Right. Yeah. Again, the green peppers are perennial plants. They will grow for several years. You just protect them from freezing, or even if they do get nipped a little, you can many times cut them back and they come back up. And they do like, again, plenty of sun, but as the heat of the summer comes, they do benefit from a little bit of shade.
Shade, yeah. Okay, well, thanks for the information. I think I'll kind of give up the idea on that side of the building and for something like that and go with, I don't know what I'm going to go with yet, but I'll figure something out.
Well, you might even think of putting them in containers with a roller to where you could move them and move them back at times, you know, put them out at least 2, 3, or 4 days a week, maybe out in your sunny area, roll it back around to the other side if you need to just tuck them over there. But if you're putting them in the ground, it's a little tough.
That's tough, yeah. Okay, well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Bye now.
Thank you, Hugh. And let's have another phone call. Carol Ann, good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann Baldwin.
Good morning, Carol Ann. I have a question about my hedge.
Okay.
It's Laura Pudlum, something like that. Okay. I don't know the exact pronunciation.
Right, you got it.
And last year I called you because one of the bushes in my hedge died, and you gave me some good advice about putting a smaller one in there and just letting it catch up with the other...
Right.
The bushes, but not only did the bush that I put in the same spot die, but two spots down in the hedge, if you can, you know, visualize, you know,
right,
a row
right.
of bushes, two spots down, one of the bushes is also, all the leaves are dropping off and it's going, so obviously something's attacking my hedge. What would that be, and am I just going to have to give up on that hedge? Two questions there.
Yeah, that's a tough one because it sounds like if the leaves you say the leaves are dropping off.
Yeah, the leaves are dropping off just like the other the leaves turn brown and they drop off and the plant just withers and dies.
Just withers and dies. Is it on any kind of irrigation?
It's not on irrigation, no.
Okay, but I guess I'm trying to get back through the whole step by step on it on. Whether or not it was an established hedge, obviously.
Yes, the bushes were about chest high.
Okay, and but they only get water unless if nature waters it.
Right. They only get watered when it rains, basically.
Okay, but are they in an area where, yes, they can get that, not up too close to the house where the house is blocking some of that?
No, actually, it's on the property line, so it's wide open.
Out in the landscape. Okay. I was just making sure that it wasn't just that they were not getting enough water when it did rain, because established shrubs don't need a whole lot of it, additional as to what nature gives them. Is there anybody that's spraying anything like a Roundup or using a weed and feed in those areas?
Well, my neighbor on that side is not what you'd call a master gardener. He pretty much left his lawn just, go to a natural state,
okay,
so I doubt anybody would be spraying anything on there.
Yeah, he's not spraying anything from his side, but there's no weed and feed or anything that's getting scattered up underneath there?
No.
Okay. Yeah, I'm trying to go through what it could be. I'm not sure of a specific pest that would attack the Laura petalum. It does sound like it's, I don't know, or a specific fungus. I can probably try to look something up. May not have it this week, but get back on the air with it next week or so. And see whether or not there's something in particular that is attacking the Laura petalum. I haven't really heard of anything offhand, but there could be a problem.
The odd thing for me, Caroline, is that it's skipped. It's not just marching down the hedge. It skipped one of the bushes, and went to the next spot. And that's the weird thing. But I don't think I'm going to replace them. I may end up digging the whole thing up and... Then I'll call you to find out what to put in there.
Okay. Well, we'll see whether or not we may be able to find a, because even just flipping through, taking a look in my book, it's generally this tough pest-free plant tolerates heat and drought. And basically any well-drained soil, so I don't know whether or not you had an area maybe that there's some clay that it actually stays wetter, can suffer from a chlorosis, which is a yellowing of leaves, if the soil is too alkaline, but once established, grows fast. And at least based on this, I'll have to look and see if there's anything updated for you and anybody else.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, thank you, Pete.
Good luck there.
And Carolyn, you got another phone call. Good morning. You're on the air with Carolyn.
Good morning, Carolyn and Larry.
Good morning.
So, listen, I'd like to propose and request that WOCA increased Carolyn's radio time because you decreased gardening time on Sunday with the Garden Rebel.
Did we? I think maybe he did that. I don't think it was our thing.
Who did that?
I guess the garden guy did, because I don't know. Maybe it's out of... I don't know. Did we decrease it?
I don't know. There's some kind of...
It could be that his stuff didn't get renewed through there, or he was off because it was Mother's Day.
Oh, okay.
No, for a couple of weeks now. I think it's Fran Tarkington or somebody.
Okay, yeah, you're right. Yes, I forgot. Yes.
That's football, dude.
So
Carolyn is going to have to be given more airtime to make up for that decrease in Sunday gardening.
Well, you know what we could do? We could just speed it up, and then she get more words in 1 hour.
More words in an hour. Actually, that's pretty fast.
Okay, that would work. Larry, you're just such a problem solver.
It was a technological thing, you know.
There you go. That's it.
But it came from your brain, Larry. Okay, so that's all I wanted to share this morning.
Oh, all right.
Thank you, Carolyn.
No, you're welcome. Have a good day.
And I don't know the Garden Rebel guy. What's his real name, do you know?
Robert Vincent Sims.
There you go. And everybody loves this guy.
He's good. He's semi-local, too, but he's not me.
No, but he's not you. But he also has I have a hard time understanding him.
Oh.
I don't know. I don't know. He doesn't open his mouth all the way or something.
Oh, could be.
If he's listening right now.
I don't know.
He's listening.
And before we get more calls, because it would be right after this show, so somebody would actually have to travel with their radio on if they wanted to catch this program over at the Ag Center this morning. It's the Tuesday gardening series, and this one is the watering your lawn and landscape, and it's one with learn about your watering needs, timing, and application, and how to troubleshoot your irrigation problems. And I had another, that's what happens when you move the book, another sheet gave me a little more details on it, but it's out in the demonstration gardens at the Ag Center, and it's free. So you will, part of it may be in the auditorium, and then they'll go out to the garden and show you some of the systems out there. If you've never had an irrigation system and you're thinking about putting one in, whether it's for vegetables or flowers, or adjusting yours to, or changing it to maybe a micro system, they can answer the questions on that. And that's the Tuesdays in the garden series. It goes on the second Tuesday of each month from 10 to noon. So they were smart. They didn't put it on earlier so folks can actually listen to the show and then go over to the website. We don't want to have any interference going on. So.
You know, Pete was asking about his hedge, and I wanted to ask you something. And this is probably a dopey question, but can any bush be a hedge? It's not a plant, right? Hedge is not a plant, right?
No, a hedge is not a specific type of plant. A hedge is where they're placed.
Okay.
So you can have a specimen shrub, and you can have a hedge of those same shrubs. A hedge would be a line, a continuous, whether used for privacy or property demarcation, and things like that.
So if I were to go to the gardening store and say I would like a hedge, I want to buy a hedge, the first question
would be is, well, besides the location of where you want to put it, because that would adjust based upon your size that you're looking for. Are you looking for a hedge to run in front of the home under the windows where you look for something smaller? Or are you looking for that hedge to run along the back fence so that your backyard party isn't visible from your neighbors?
Got it, yeah. Yeah, I like the kind. This is my personal taste. I like the kind, whatever, I don't know what plant it is, but it's thick enough that you can almost... carve it, not carve it, but you know,
okay,
shape
right.
it, shape
you
it.
Shape it, right,
yeah, yeah.
Right.
I like those kind. I don't know why. I just do.
Well, they're nice and dense, and they're more formal in those type of settings where they're generally shaped off as a square or rectangle. Sometimes they're rounded at the top, but even those hedges that you put out there as that demarcation line, make sure that when you're pruning them properly so that they stay thick in the middle, because so many times we just take the hedge clippers and we just cut them straight down in a straight line from the top to the bottom of them and cut straight across the top, when really the bottom should be slightly wider than the top is. So doing them as a ball is not necessarily the best type thing, because the bottom is cut very short, the center is much wider, but you need to let that light and air, when you prune them to improve the appearance and to encourage new growth. So you do need to do them to where you're going to get that light and that air circulation going through the plant, so that when it grows in, it's going to stay full in the middle, not one that 10 years down the line you're looking in and going, ooh, that's awful thin in the middle. When I cut it back, it's ugly for the next 2 months until it begins to fill back in. If you prune them where the top is a little more narrow, nothing too drastic. If it was a hedge that was, say, 4 feet across the top and a 8-foot hedge, it might be 5 feet at the bottom. So just a small amount of an angle, you know, in that area. Not a whole lot. You're going to see it too much. And that'll allow that light to penetrate much more surface area of the hedge itself.
If you were working at a gardening shop, let's say in the Northeast or way out west, mm-hmm. I'm guessing that question, what's a good plant to serve as a hedge? The answer would be different because you're in a different location, right?
Right. But you may have some that would overlap. Or it would be a different variety within the same family, like a holly you can still, you have hollies up in the northeast, and we do also have hollies down here, not necessarily the same ones. So it would be something,
gotcha,
you know, you may
gotcha.
Find something a similar
right.
look to what you're going after. So it's, you know, it's moreover when you're looking, if you do happen to, or say you've come from the Northeast or the Midwest and you've come to Florida, you can always ask in a garden center or in a nursery, I'm looking to put a hedge in, I'm familiar with these plants, do you and I like them, do you have anything that's similar? And we may have some, because, you know, a ligustrum will grow up, you know, not just in Florida, but will go further up, I'm not sure it's full range. Again, the hollies, you may not get the same holly that you grew in upstate New York as you would grow here in Central Florida, just because the climate differences.
By the way, let me just mention the phone number, and then I have a quick observation I want to share with you. The phone number, if you'd like to call Caroline right now, you are invited to do so. Caroline is not in the studio, but she's live in her car calling in, and she can hear you if you call. The number is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-WOCA. If you have a question, it does not have to be about something we're talking about. You might want to bring something out of left field. And here's my observation. You know, years ago, we planted this camellia in the Cascades Garden.
Right.
And I know you explained to me that the reason it's not getting any bigger is probably because I neglected to spread out the roots when I planted it.
Quite possible.
Okay. Well, here's my observation. I watch the gardening guys here
right.
cutting down things that get too big.
Right.
So maybe I accidentally did the right thing.
To keep them from cutting it down later.
Yeah, because it'll stay small probably all the... Right?
It will stay small over time. It's just, I know you're saying it somewhat in a bit of humor on with it, but it's true. It probably will stay a little smaller. It's also quite possible that it will not have the longevity of a plant that, when properly planted, where its roots can go out much further. And that type of situation is a lot of times I have seen it. I've worked with it, and it makes you question and I have no idea who the landscaper was, and it may not be the landscaper himself. It might have been his helpers, just not knowing where people will go through and they run through an auger, or they make a hole, and then somebody comes through and takes the pot off the plant, drops it in the hole, covers it back up, gives it a drink, and the job is done in an hour and a half, and off they go with their check in hand. Five years later, those bushes are the same size, or some of them may be dying off, they're failing to thrive, and when you come back through, which I did, it was through a volunteer program, actually with one of the high schools, one of those, the Day of Caring events, we pulled up these plants, or the students did, and they looked like the same plant that went in the ground 5 years earlier, and they had failed to thrive. They were not growing.
Oh,
they
man.
Were,
and that's what I did.
Yeah. And that might be what you did. So we may, well, before we run over to the mall, maybe we'll have to dig that up and take it with us and put it in a big pot.
Oh, that'd be cool. We'll need some guidance, though. I think I might make a mistake again.
Well, we'll figure out how to
we'll
do
that. We'll do a video. We'll do a video of everything
we'll
now.
We'll do a video of how to transplant it.
All right, let's go back to the phone. Good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
Hey, Larry. Hey, Carol Ann.
Good morning.
This is Ann.
Yes.
What I was calling about, I've recently, my son gave me chickens, and we're still working on building their home. I have them in another contained temporary area. But what I'm concerned about is, are there plants that would be poisonous? Like, I have that air potato. I've tried to get rid of a lot of it, but once you've got it, as you know, Carol Ann, you've got it
for a while.
And I'm wondering, are there things that are poisonous to chickens? Because I can't hear you on the phone, so I'm going to have to hang up. If there's something that you shouldn't have, that like deadly nightshade and China berry trees and
things that they, you're right,
yeah,
things that they may eat. Right, I gotcha.
Okay, I'm going to have to hang up because I'm making a screech.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Okay, yeah, the question being, she's acquired some chickens and is wondering if anything in her landscape is going to make them sick or kill them. Birds like that, animals like that, are generally very smart. They may not look like it. I never had them have an issue with anything that they ate in my landscape. Most of the time they're after insects and things like that. You might use a little caution having lantana around, because lantana is very toxic. But again, I don't know whether or not they'd really have to enjoy it, I think, to consume enough to make them sick. They're not a grazing animal. They're more, you know, they're a scratching animal. They're looking for bugs and seeds and things in the ground more than on the plant itself. They will consume some plant material, but usually your biggest problem will be that they will totally replant your flower beds.
Really?
Several years ago, actually my daughter was still in elementary school, and we had gotten into the chickens and the couple of ducks and a couple more chickens, and then a fence around my garden because I had planted gingers, and they got in and mixed them all up where they dug everything up because it was nice fresh soil, nice easy thing to scratch around in, and they had a grand time, and it was interesting when my gingers came up later to find out where they went.
I think if I had chickens, I'd be more worried about not what they eat, but what gets to eat them.
Yeah, that's the biggest issue, is what may come through to try to eat them, because the hawks will grab them. The big scissor-tail kites can get them.
Really?
Owls at night, if you're not getting them put up. I'm not exactly sure where she's at in the county. I know by us there's coyotes out where I know where you live, and I'm not far from there, and the coyotes...
And lately I've been having a bunch... I mean, I haven't seen them, but I hear owls every... You know, I get up at 3 a.m. and I hear these owls. Like they sound like they're right on my car.
Right, right. Right now I believe they're mating, and all that rest of that fun nature stuff is going on with the owls. Normally, though, you put your chickens up at night, and they will automatically... You train them, they will go in to a pen at night, and because they do like to roost, and they don't fly well. They don't fly at all, actually, except for very short distances and very clumsily. But moreover, having an issue with them eating things that would make them sick, I don't have a resource offhand of anything on chickens, but I've never had them get into anything as a big concern. Again, I think my biggest one would be the lantana of what they made,
which is poisonous to everybody, isn't it?
Right. Yeah. Everything else is pretty safe. Or sometimes they're just contact where they'll make us itch, and it doesn't do anything to a chicken. Try to encourage them to scratch in another part. She may have to put a little decorative fence around to discourage them out of there. But those little fences, sometimes, yes, they can hop over those.
Carolyn, we are at the bottom of the hour, so we need to take a little break.
Okay.
Carolyn's show is brought to you in part by...
Black Cow Cow Manure.
Black Cow Cow Manure. And we'll take a little break and be right back. If you would like to chat with Carolyn, maybe with a question, maybe just to kind of chat, the phone number is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-9622. Carolyn is live today on May 14th. She's just not in the studio. She's in her car out there somewhere. We'll take a little break and we'll be right back.
Are you still fertilizing flowers and vegetables the old-fashioned way?
Then switch to Dynamite. Dynamite Complete Plant Food. The secret to more flowers, bigger blooms, and more vegetables is consistent feeding. Dynamite Complete Plant Food has a unique protective coating that releases nutrition consistently, so there are no highs and lows. Dynamite is complete nutrition. It contains the micronutrients plants need in small quantities for maximum growth. With Dynamite, you get an explosion of color, flowers, and vegetables. Dynamite comes in a handy shake and feed plastic bottle. Just one application will last up to 6 months. For more flowers, bigger blooms, and more vegetables, try Dynamite today. Visit our website and learn more about the science behind the modern, long-lasting way to feed your flowers and vegetables at dynamiteplantfood.com. Dynamite Complete Plant Food.
This is Don with ABC Frederick's Appliance. Here's my daughter, Lena.
And hey, everybody, it's Lena. You need to come down to ABC Frederick's Appliance on County Road 25, just over the railroad tracks in Bellevue, where you are treated right with the right products like Whirlpool, Maytag, Crosley, and Speed Queen. These are the new ones. Don't forget, we also carry used appliances that we warranty. ABC Frederick's Appliance does repairs, too. Call us at 629-5181. ABC Frederick's Appliance on County Road 25, just over the railroad tracks in Bellevue. It's at 629-5181.
All right, thank you. 25 minutes before 10 o'clock, let's rejoin Carol Ann Baldwin. This is her show, You've Got a Garden, and if you have a question for Carol Ann, the number is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-9622. Welcome back, Carol Ann, and you have somebody waiting on hold.
All right.
Good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
Good morning, everyone. I've got a little project that I'm going to do, and it's put flowers in. And I've got a border that's about 3 feet wide, and it's going the front of my home, on the length of the side of the home, and then the back. I'm not going to do one side, but even though I know flowers and I know this and I know that, I just don't really know what would work good there, and what would come back, is there bushes that excuse me. They look like flowers, and what would you recommend that I plant in there for color?
Is it mostly a sunny area?
Actually, one side is half of it is at the front. Half of it is complete shade, and the other half is like semi-shade. And then the length of the house is full sun. And that faces one side of the road, and, of course, the other one is the back part, and it's sunny. Two sides are full sun. Yeah,
okay.
just kind of give me an idea of what to go and check out in the sense of flowers or even bushes that look like flowers. You know, that have color in them.
Yeah, I was gonna say on the side that's a lot of shade and things. You can go with gingers; they like the shade. Ferns. The alpine ginger is a green and white. It's moreover for the foliage versus the flower, you know, so it doesn't really flower, but it's a good size little plant, good size plant, about 3 feet or so high or better, by about the same spread. It's a green and white that gives some color. It's pretty hardy to the cold, and in the shade you're generally a little bit protected anyway. The stromanthia is another plant that looks a lot like the gingers, but it's a tricolored plant. It's like a burgundy, a green, and white, which, again, no flowers.
What was the name of that one?
Stromanthia.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. If you walked into a place and said, it looks like a ginger, but it's got three colors on the leaves, they might know what you mean. But those are real nice, you know, as just, you know, something unique within the area, whether or not you wanted to put them in the ground or put them into a large container, an urn. Ferns work well in those areas. There's several hardy ferns out there, like holly fern and macho fern, that are very hardy.
Yeah,
and
was my next question, was what would be hardy and, you know, kind of resist the winter and the hot sun and all that.
Sure.
And so are you saying that these plants are, because I was hearing another one of your shows, are they like number 9? Is that what that region is?
Ours, we're within like an 8B to a 9A. So you really don't want anything that's going to say that it's for zone 10. That's just a little bit too far south. But if you had, you know, an 8B to the 9A area is, sometimes reading those tags gets a little confusing because it'll say a zone 8, and why is it in this store? Well, it can tolerate our area pretty well. Again, the 9, but looking at the 10s and 11s, that is much more tropical. Sometimes you'll even see plants in the stores that'll say it's for zone 7. Well, that means it's going to tolerate usually more cold, but it should be able to take our climate as well.
Okay. Okay, well, you gave me some ideas, and I appreciate it. Thank you so very
much. You're welcome. You're welcome. Yeah, going with trying to find plants for folks that are going to do in shade gets to be a tough one. We always had, you know, usually you think of with annuals and stuff, of impatiens and begonias, there's Torina, there's a few others, the coleus, but everybody keeps looking for impatiens this year and you're not going to find them. If you do, I still wouldn't recommend putting them in the landscape. You might put them in a hanging basket or find them in a hanging basket. But they're the issue, the reason you're not finding them, and I know it made at least one article, I'm not sure if it made any of our papers or the Ocala paper or the Gainesville paper, but it was in, the one down in Lake County, that they are succumbing to downy mildew in the landscape, and there's nothing you can do about it. So when everybody's been looking for impatiens, and again, if you noticed, you haven't seen them probably in over a year. They're not growing them. They're trying to breed out or breed into them a resistance to this disease. Now, the New Guinea impatiens and the sun patients are not affected by it. So those can make some substitutions, but the sun patients, as the name says, do like the sun for them to bloom their best, though they do like water when they're out there in the sun.
And that echoes probably from the phone call. We have a phone call. Good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
Good morning. This is Andrea. Good morning, Larry and Carol Ann.
Morning.
Morning.
I have a question, Carol. I can hardly hear you, but I'm going to ask the question and hang up and then listen on the radio. I have a hibiscus that I purchased last year, and per your instructions, it's grown beautiful, but it's not blooming, so I don't know what I'm doing wrong. So
not
blooming.
I am going
to hang up to listen to the radio, okay?
Okay. And I get the question, it's a hibiscus, it's looking good, but it's not blooming. There's several different reasons why plants won't bloom. Sometimes we use a fertilizer that's too high in nitrogen. You will get a gorgeous plant and no flowering or no fruiting, depending on what your what type of plants you're growing. The hibiscus also can get a flower thrip, which you'll see buds on the plant, but you will not end up getting any blooms out of it because this insect is inside of the flower bud, damaging it, and next thing you know, the buds are falling off. Another little pesky critter we have, you know, with the thrip, we can spray with an insecticide or use a systemic, and that'll help to control those. The other one we don't have an insecticide for, it's called a squirrel. And they will get in your hibiscus trees and bushes, and they will eat the flower buds. Many times you will find the shredded flower buds on the ground underneath them. If it's that you've, that if they're not blooming and you're not sure on your fertilization, leave the Miracle-Gro stuff on the shelf because that's a good one to get you a whole lot of plant and not a whole lot of flowers necessarily. And fertilizing on a regular basis like that, it may just be causing it to grow too much greenery. So I would slack off on that, and it's hard to say otherwise of why it wouldn't be, but those would be my couple guesses would possibly be that it's making buds, but it may have a thrip. Look a little closer inside the bush, look underneath, see if there's buds dropping to the ground. And then, again, with the fertilizer, of lay off the fertilizer, and hopefully it's getting enough sun because they do like full sun.
Carolyn, just now, I hope I can change the subject a little bit. I've been seeing articles and Facebook posts about Roundup, and it's getting some bad press. What is the truth? What is going on with the Roundup, and why is it getting bad press?
Well, I haven't heard a whole lot on recently myself on that. I mean, the Monsanto company always is getting bad press.
Yeah.
Everybody loves to hate Monsanto. Roundup itself, probably because of the GMOs, has that those crops that have been treated to or bred to where they're resistant to the effects of Roundup, so that the farmer can go through his fields and spray with Roundup to kill the weeds. There are weeds that are becoming resistant to the Roundup. Not normally in somebody's landscape as much as unless you have overused the product.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that the seed, as soon as, you know, we begin to change things, just like pesticides, it all outbreeds, you know, what we're spraying. You know, we as human beings don't, you know, we don't have the possibility to breed our entire lives. And when we do, it's, you know, at the maximum once every, you know, once a year. When you're dealing with weeds and things like that, those are creating new seed very frequently. If you've missed killing one and a new seed or a root happens to stay alive, you may be breeding yourself a resistant plant to those herbicides.
I got you. And that'll take what, a few years or something, or?
It might take a couple of years, but you figure how many years we've been spraying Roundup.
Yeah, right, right. Oh,
and right, and so sometimes even, and a lot of many times too, when people will use products at the wrong time. Timing, I think I've said it a lot of different times, is very important. Temperatures are crucial. If you spray Roundup in February, you figure you're going to get rid of all those weeds before the spring starts, but the high temperatures are only in the low to mid-60s, and the lows are down into the 40s, it's not going to take it up. The plant's not going to process that chemical and be killed off. And again, then you start that whole cycle of possibly, you know, breeding yourself weeds that are resistant to the herbicide, as well as a frustration that you're not getting the job done. You know, so a lot of times, you know, spraying Roundup in January and February is almost, it's a waste of money, because it's not near as effective as a nice warm sunny day of putting it down when you get up in the morning and it's already 62 degrees, 65 degrees. It's going to be a clear sky going to 85 degrees. The Roundup's way more effective on a day like that than it is on a bright sunny day in the wintertime when the high is 65 and the low is 42. It's just, Roundup's just not effective on those temperatures.
Are you in town right now?
I'm south of town.
South of town. In what, Leesburg?
Lady Lake.
Lady Lake, okay. Oh, close.
Yeah.
And the villages.
Yeah.
Okay. And mm-hmm. And are we allowed to say where you are, or?
I don't care.
You're at Lowe's, right?
I'm at Lowe's. Yeah, okay. I'm at work. I'm sitting out in the parking lot in the tree line.
And the only reason I bring it up was to ask you what's happening at the garden centers around, not just at Lowe's, but at the different ones that we might be able to take advantage of right now.
Well, right now we are into the summer flowers. It's I'm still getting folks, and of course a lot of these people, at least in the store I'm at, and other areas too, where we always have year after year, we have new people who were snowbirds who have decided to make their year-round home here in the area, but they're still looking now instead of being back home where they may have been planting petunias. Now we're done planting those kind of plants. So we should be fully transitioned to those summer blooming annuals. The perennials are up and blooming. If you drive any of our roadways here around up and down 441 on 301, you'll see the phlox and the gallardia and the tickseed and all those are blooming. Those wildflowers, you can buy plants like that and put them in your landscape. You don't have to start them from seed. They will generally reseed themselves. Some of the ones in the garden centers may be hybrids where the seed may or may not come back true to seed when they drop. And then most of us get tired of seeing those ugly flowers when they're sitting there, so we don't allow them to go to seed in the landscape. But all of those type of plants are blooming. Any pruning that's going on is done now to get, is almost like deadheading and maintaining again. You can still put in more perennials now. It's a good time. Our summer rains haven't started. even your shrubs, bringing in some fresh landscape shrubs, doing a new bed. It's not too late to do that. Our nice rains of the year haven't started, which they help us with the irrigation. If you are planning a new bed, make sure that, you know, and it always sounds a little funny to say sandy soil, you know, and many think it's an oxymoron, but that is, our soil is very sandy. But adding a couple bags of black cow in if you're going to do a planting, if you're going to plant a large tree, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to do a mending because it won't be 6 months and those roots are no longer in that area. They will be out in the middle of the yard within a year and a half. But if you're planting a couple shrubs and some perennials, when you decide to do that area, getting, you know, 2, 3, 4 bags of black cow, of any other, you know, of just a garden soil, don't use potting mix. It doesn't blend in, and mix that within the native sandy soil. You're going to increase the nutrition, you're going to increase the water holding capabilities, and you know you'll get your plants off to a good start.
In just a little bit, I have a question that I will ask, and we will give away a $20 gift certificate to Bob Wine's Camellia Gardens and Nursery. And I guess it's more along the lines of a generic question, I guess. So.
Got going with the generics today. Huh?
Yeah, so you couldn't be in the studio today because you're very busy down there. And,
yeah.
And so is that what you were just describing? Is that what's so busy? Is what all?
It's a lot of, yeah. There's a lot of folks that I'm attributing it to, that folks have gone ahead and stayed this year, whether or not they have been affected by Hurricane Sandy of last year, this past winter, and that they just went ahead and decided they already were here, they'll go ahead and stay. But I am seeing, it seems to be it was a very busy weekend. And I had a big delivery yesterday and I'm off tomorrow, so I needed to get a little more done today. So that's why I decided to come into work early and call the show in. I could take an hour and be back to work in 5 minutes from the walk to the parking lot.
Yeah, right. If you have a question for Carolyn, we've got a few more minutes before I ask my trivia question. The number right now is the same as always, the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-WOCA, if you got something going on in your garden. I would imagine the cooler temperatures right now. Is it still cool out there? I guess it is, right?
Yeah, I think it's still pretty nice
out
right
now.
Nice breeze blowing. Don't do any spraying today.
Do you think that cool air we had last night actually stimulated the plants in any way?
It may actually on some of the plants, especially if you did have some of the winter bloomers that they're still in the ground or they're still in hanging baskets, they're going to be a little happier. They're still going to look pretty good for another few weeks, till we really start getting hot, till those rains begin. Normally, here the end of this month, first part of June, when we start getting all that, you know, the normal rain we get, that puts a soaking to everything. That's when everybody will start losing those. Winter ones will really be going away pretty quickly after that. But yeah, I think the cool temperatures, they kind of encourage some of those other ones that might not like the heat quite so much.
Right.
You may not need to water, you know, today, only because it was nice and cool and they're not being affected near as much.
I wonder if it's going to be a cooler than usual year in general. So far it has been. I mean, we're already into May.
Right, we are. It's hard to say once it finally breaks. I've heard we were supposed to be warmer than normal, but you know what truly is normal when you're speaking of weather.
Yeah, right. Right. Well, I mean May. I mean, there's only 12 months in the year. This is already the fifth one.
Right, and we normally are much warmer than we have been over the last few weeks.
Oh yeah.
We've been chilly. So it's been. Hey, I'm not complaining.
No, I'm not either. I'm not either. But you like it warmer, don't you?
I do. Well, I don't like to be cold. That's what it is. I just don't like to be cold. This morning, I had to have the jacket on to go out of the house. So, but it's warmed up nicely now though.
All right, I have here, I don't know what I did with it, but I know what here it is, a $20 gift certificate to Bob Wine's Camellia Gardens and Nursery, and I have a question that will win this $20 gift certificate for somebody out there. The phone number to call to answer the question is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-9622. If you're out of the area, use the area code 352-622-9622. You ready for the question?
Ready.
All right, I'm looking for the name of an organization. It started at the Kansas City Baltimore Hotel with 33 young farm boys. And it started in 1928. And we have an organization, or chapter of that organization, probably several chapters right here in Ocala.
Right.
But what organization am I talking about?
What is that organization?
Do you know
that's
that?
A good question.
Do you know it?
I believe I do.
Okay.
It's only one of two things.
Okay.
Only one of two that I know of.
Do you mind? What do you think it is?
Future Farmers of America.
It is Future Farmers of America.
There you go.
And my name is Carol Morgan.
Carol Morgan.
Carol.
Oh, Carol Morgan.
I'm calling for Carol.
Yeah, I got you. Okay.
This is Dennis.
All right, Dennis. You got it. It'll be waiting for Carol then.
Okay.
Carol, I presume, is your wife, right?
Yes.
All right, Dennis, thank you.
All right, thank you.
Appreciate that. Yeah, boy, was that too easy?
That was really not really.
Well, you knew it, but you said it could have been another. What's the other?
It could have also been the 4-H.
Oh, the 4-H.
Because I don't remember when 4-H was formed and how. But the Future Farmers of America, that makes sense.
So 33 young farm boys started the whole thing.
Look at there.
There must have been some grown-up involved at that. I mean, it's a bunch of boys.
Well, I don't know. Back, what was the year?
1928.
Well, kids in those days were
more mature.
I don't know. They had it more together.
They didn't have iPods. They didn't have handheld games.
They didn't have the didn't have TVs. Didn't have movies. They were worried about going to on Saturday night. Well, by the time they were 15, 16 years old, they'd probably been halfway running the farm with their fathers and uncles.
Have you ever seen, Carolyn, I don't know what it is, it's TED, it's something to do with inspirational speakers or something. Have you ever seen videos by this group called TED?
No, I don't believe so.
All right, I'm probably doing it an injustice. But anyway, every once in a while I'll see a video, and there was a young boy standing in front of this group called TED, and and the young boy was saying that, he looked maybe to be 10,
okay.
And he said, you know, when I was younger, I wanted to be an NFL football star. but I've changed my mind. Now I want to be a farmer. And he went on to explain why he thought that being a farmer would enable him to contribute more to the world than being a football player. But
wow.
It's
kind of funny that, back when I was younger, and he's all of 10.
Right. Yeah.
That is amusing.
And he got a lot of applause with that line, I guess, because, you know, as we get older, we realize that the dreams we all had when we were younger may have been a little bit on the superficial side. So.
Right, a little far-fetched. Well, when they want to grow up to be the fire truck, it's, not necessarily the fireman, but they want to be the fire truck because it's cool, it's red, it has sirens and all kinds of carries all the neat stuff.
Well, always do a good show, even when you're not in the studio, but I prefer you to be in here, you know. I'm selfish. I'm just being selfish.
And I should be back next week.
Carolyn, thank you so much. Have a great day. Don't work too hard, all right?
I'm going to try not to. I'm going to work smart, not hard.
And hopefully we didn't run down the battery on your phone
car. I'm plugged in.
I know. All right, well, thank you, Carolyn. We'll talk to you next week.
Talk to you soon.
All right.
Bye-bye now.
We will take a little break right now, and we'll be right back. Our next guests are coming into the studio to talk to us about Ocala. Melanie Gabordi is coming on. She is the Senior Manager of Economic Development of Revitalization for the city of Ocala, which might have something to do with plants. And Mark Mondale is the Executive Director of Municipal Development for the city of Ocala. They are coming in to talk to us about some of the revitalization projects for the city. Can't wait to hear about them. We've seen a lot of good progress lately in the last several years, actually. And what a big, big difference it's all made. We'll take a little break and be right back.
Ocala's information station, 1370 WOCA. Ocala!
ABC News Now. I'm Karen Chase. Former rivals are joining forces to promote safe driving. Wireless carriers AT&T, Verizon, Sprint, and T-Mobile are the driving force behind a new awareness campaign called It Can Wait, using ads to highlight the dangers of texting while driving. Angelina Jolie calls it a difficult choice, but the right one for her family. After undergoing a preventative double mastectomy, she did it after discovering she was genetically predisposed to breast cancer. One of the Cleveland policemen who rescued...